Theories, snorted Inspector Abeline after his retirement. We're almost lost in theories, there are so many of them. A drunken freelance journalist called Robert Donston Stevenson joined forces with another lush to investigate Dr. Morgan Davis of the London Hospital, whom Stevenson claimed to have seen simulate the Ripper's methods with frightening conviction. He also claimed, wrongly, that the women had been sodomized, which had been a part of Dr. Davis's mimetic technique. When these two amateur detectives came to the notice of the police, Stevenson's own eccentric behaviour seems to have brought him under temporary suspicion. But Inspector Roots vouched for him as a hopeless alcoholic drug addict who had known better days, and for the time being he passed out of the picture. If he was the Robert Stevenson who was summoned for indecent assault in Whitechapel on October the 30th, he needed investigation as clearly as John Pizer. A recurrent press suggestion at this time was that the immigrant community in the East End believed the murderer to be a mad Russian medical student who had been released from an asylum in Paris early in 1888 and declared his intention of coming to London. His name was Nikolai Vasily, or Vasiliev. He had joined a bizarre self-castrating sect before exiling himself to Paris. There he had attacked a prostitute and been put away. An American journalist called R.K. Fox wrote an instant book on the case, giving the romantic twist that Vasily had fallen in love with a prostitute called Madeleine in Paris, and then set out to save her by killing her and four other prostitutes in the space of 2 weeks. No independent evidence of this mad Russian's existence has yet been traced. As December came to a close, it seemed that the murders might have stopped, and the police prepared to reduce the expensive patrols flooding Whitechapel. And as police interest diminished, so public concern flagged. Mr. Lusk and his associates were less vociferous, and a professional agitator named Albert Batchett, who would take over the Vigilance Committee by 1891, became the loudest protesting voice in the East End. According to a somewhat unreliable source, Dr. Thomas Dutton, as reported by Donald McCormick, the police told Batchett confidentially in March 1889 that the case was closed because the Ripper had died by drowning at the end of the previous year. 1889 established pioneer theorists in two nuisance areas. Dr. Littleton Forbes Winslow pressed himself forcefully back into the picture, telling sympathetic reporters that he knew who the Ripper was, he possessed his blood-stained boots, and if given 6 policemen, he would arrest him on one of his visits to St. Paul's Cathedral. This had to be investigated, and Swanson and Abeline interviewed the man whom the press hailed as one of the greatest living experts on crime, since he had both medical and legal qualifications, and had played a major role in securing the reprieve of some rather nasty young people named Staunton when they starved a mentally handicapped woman to death in 1877. The great alienist piped rather smaller, faced with serious investigation in 1889. He had been misreported in the press. He did not really think the man in question was the Ripper. He was merely recounting a story he'd received from a Mr. and Mrs. Callahan, formerly of Sun Street, Finsbury Square, and he believed the police had already investigated it. Essentially, the Callahan story was that a lodger of theirs, G. Wentworth Bell Smith, had aroused their suspicion. He had offices near St. Paul's, and frequently came home protesting that prostitutes visited the edifice, and they should all be drowned. He wrote screeds of religio-maniac ravings. He kept a pistol in his drawer. He was often out until the small hours of the morning, and changed his suit every day. On the night of Martha Tabram's murder, he had returned home in a very dishevelled state, telling a cock-and-bull story about having his watch stolen in Bishopsgate. The Callahans had now moved to Victoria Park, but had subsequently heard from a young woman about a suspicious man she'd watched washing his hands under a standpipe after one of the murders, and followed to Sun Street. The Callahans were sure this was also Bell Smith. Forbes Winslow produced the famous blood-stained boots, and the police noted that they were old, moth-eaten, felt-topped galoshes, and the stains were not blood. They also noted, extremely acidly, that a date had been altered on Mr. Callahan's written statement to make it correspond with Martha Tabram's murder. Winslow hastened to agree with them that there was nothing in this widely publicized tale for which he blamed the press. which didn't stop him from going back to the papers with it again and again to the end of his life, falsely claiming to have detected and scared off the Ripper. In his memoirs, he claimed to have received a personal letter from Jack the Ripper at the time of the murders, and he reproduced it in facsimile, showing the famous name and the personal taunts. Unfortunately, the facsimile also shows that the date had been altered from 1889, when Winslow was much in the news with his claim to have detected the Ripper, back to 1888, when the Ripper was doing his actual killing. The similarity to the forged Callahan statement is obvious. Forbes Winslow was the first lamentable self-inflating fraud to batten on the Ripper case. Mr. Edward Knight Larkins, a clerk in the customs office, also got into his stride. Mr. Larkins had first approached the police in November 1888, when he accused one Antonio Pricci of being the murderer. This proved to be an error, but Mr. Larkins was obsessed with the idea that the Ripper must be Portuguese. He also noted that the murders tended to happen around weekends, with a preference for the first or last weekend of every month. This suggested to him the docking times of two freighters, the City of London and the City of Oporto, and he studied their sailing times and crews. It led him to accuse a succession of Portuguese seamen, altering names and dates whenever conclusive evidence was shown that any particular man he accused of any particular murder was not in London at the time. His accusations were investigated by the consul in Oporto and found groundless. Nonetheless, Mr. Larkins printed schedules of his chosen vessel's movements and bombarded the authorities with letters for 3 years. In 1893, Dr. Anderson sent an exasperated minute to the Home Office, stating correctly that Larkins was a troublesome busybody who simply refused to accept that his worthless theory had been completely disproved. Would that he had been the last. Dr. Neil Cream was executed in 1892. This cross-eyed Canadian poisoner killed a number of Lambeth prostitutes, and the rumour flew around that his last words on the scaffold were, "I am Jack the..." Since they're not mentioned in the memoirs of executioner Billington, it seems unlikely that they were ever uttered. In any case, they were not true. Cream was in Joliet Prison, Illinois, during the latter part of 1888. Attempts during the 1980s to show that Cream's handwriting was identical with some of the notorious Jack the Ripper letters, coupled with the silly suggestion that his family might have bribed the American authorities to let a look-alike replace him in Joliet, serve only to discredit the reliability of handwriting experts in general and the intelligence or common sense of wild theorists. Donald Rumbelow has traced letters written by Cream from Joliet at the time of the murders, and he was definitely not Jack the Ripper. Nor was Frederick Deeming, executed in Australia that year for murdering his wife and cementing her under the kitchen fireplace. True, he had committed earlier murders in England, cementing a previous wife and four daughters under his kitchen floor at Raynham, Liverpool. But the only thing to connect him with the Ripper was an alleged confession, denied at the time by his solicitor, that he had committed the last of the Whitechapel murders, whichever that was supposed to mean. It looks like a hopeless attempt to delay his inevitable execution in Australia, though the Australian authorities took it just seriously enough to send Deeming's death mask to Scotland Yard, where it can be seen today in the Black Museum. In February 1894, the Sun claimed to have identified Jack the Ripper. He was a madman called Thomas Cutbush, who had escaped from Lambeth Infirmary in March 1891 and stabbed two women from behind. The Sun discovered that he'd been working in the Minories until 1888, when he learned that he was infected with syphilis, gave up his job, and lost his reason. It was an attractive theory. Cutbush had worked in Ripper territory and stopped working as the murders began. He had a tendency to violence associated with the use of a knife. Sergeant McCarthy, who'd worked on the Ripper case, was allocated to the CID team which investigated the Sun's allegations. They concluded there was nothing in them. As Chief Constable Melville McNaughton noted in a report deposited on the old Ripper file, there was no likelihood that the frenzied maniac of 1888 would go to ground for 2 years and then re-emerge, tamely jabbing women in the bottom. Sometime during the early 1890s, Robert Donston Stevenson made his most important bid for infamy. Calling himself Dr. Donston, he started to associate with occultists and theosophists. He and his mistress, Mabel Collins, went for a time into the cosmetics business with Baroness Vittoria Kremers. The Baroness subsequently told a journalist that she found a tin box containing a number of blood-stained neckties in Dr. Donston's room. She added that Donston had always said the murders were a black magic ritual entailing the removal of selected organs at selected sites, and the murderer had carried away the organs hidden under his tie. The ties ultimately came into the possession of Alistair Crowley, the notorious black magician, who allegedly said that they were the Rippers, and the Ripper had been a very great black magician who gained the gift of invisibility by the magic of killing four women to form the topographical shape of a Calvary cross. A private marginal note of Crowley's, however, suggests that he ascribed the story to Vittoria Kremers and did not wholly believe it. Nothing known about Robert Donston Stevenson inspires confidence. He liked to describe himself as a doctor trained at Heidelberg and a former surgeon to Garibaldi's armies. He wrote a book on the patristic gospels and penciled elaborations of his name into the British Library catalogue. He was exactly the sort of emptily self-important man who would think it clever to make a silly woman think he was Jack the Ripper. 1895 brought the first really important historical clue about the Ripper investigation. A young man called Granger assaulted a prostitute in Spitalfields with a knife, lightly ripping her abdomen. According to a report in the Pall Mall Gazette, the police knew one witness who had unquestionably seen Jack the Ripper with his victim a few minutes before the body was found. This witness had now identified Granger as the man he had seen in 1888. Very sensibly, the Gazette remarked that his identification couldn't count for very much after 7 years. But it also remarked that the most tenable theory was that of Inspector Swanson, who'd been in charge of the case, and asserted that the murderer was a man who was now dead. It had never been published elsewhere that Swanson was in charge, so the Gazette's journalist had some good information. This was the very first clue to emerge in public that Scotland Yard had definite ideas about the Ripper's identity. During the latter part of the decade, two writers added important details. Major Arthur Griffiths, a prison governor who knew the CID chiefs personally, wrote that several homicidal lunatics came under suspicion, which was highly plausible in three cases. The first was a Polish Jew at large in the district during the murders who afterwards developed homicidal tendencies and was incarcerated in an asylum. A police constable at Mitre Square, who was the only person ever to have had a good sight of the murderer, said this Jew looked remarkably like him. Griffith's extraordinary suggestion that there was anything plausible in suspecting this Jew if his homicidal tendencies only developed after the murders tends to have been overlooked. The second suspect was a mad Russian doctor with convictions in both England and Siberia. He always carried knives and surgical instruments and was in hiding during the autumn of 1888. At least, the police were unable to find him. The third and most strongly suspected man was also a mad doctor who disappeared after Mary Jane Kelly's murder and was found dead in the Thames on December the 31st, 1888. It was believed that he committed suicide in a brainstorm. Also, that his friends suspected him. G.R. Sims, the popular playwright, journalist, and novelist, also made frequent references to the Ripper case in his weekly column of gossip, comment, and verse. Like Griffiths, he asserted that three suspects were the final shortlist. There had, he said, originally been seven names. He, too, thought that a man who had drowned in the Thames was the most likely. He believed that both his family and the police had been hunting for him before his body was found, suspecting that he was the murderer. He also thought that he travelled out to the East End from the city or the West End for the murders. But in 1903, Sims' views were decisively opposed when, from his retirement, Inspector Abelline gave two interviews to the Pall Mall Gazette, arguing that the recently executed poisoner, George Chapman, had been the Ripper. Abelline claimed to be in constant touch with Scotland Yard and to know for a fact that they had no idea who the Ripper was. He knew all about the theory that he was a young doctor who had been found in the Thames, and the Gazette could take it from him that all that amounted to was the coincidence that the murders stopped and then a body was found. He knew it was being said in certain quarters that the murderer was a man who had died in an asylum some years previously, but the Gazette could take it from Abilene there was nothing in that. As far as is known, this suggestion had never appeared in print before, though by 1895 Swanson had said the Ripper was dead, and Griffiths named two suspects who had gone to asylums. Dr. Anderson, too, in a very obscure penological article, mentioned that the Ripper went to an asylum. "Chapman must be the murderer," Abilene said, "because the motive for the murders was known, the theft of the women's wombs for sale to an American doctor. The murderer's surgical skill was apparent, and Chapman, a Polish immigrant whose real name was Severin Klosowski, had been trained in elementary surgery before he left Poland." Well, the great Abilene, the man who had claimed to have charge of the case, still believed Wynne Baxter's exploded theory of the sale of organs. Apparently he took much of his information from newspapers, since some of them had reported that Mary Jane Kelly's uterus was missing, whereas Dr. Bond's report located it firmly beneath her head. Abilene's real revelation was how much information escaped the inspectorate. In 1907, Dr. Anderson, the former head of the CID, reprinted his statement that the Ripper had been caged in a lunatic asylum. In 1910, he published his memoirs in serial form in Blackwood's magazine. Now, he said, that it was a typical case where the police might know with moral certainty who had committed a crime, but could not bring charges since the English laws protecting the innocent were so restrictive. The Ripper was a poor Polish Jew from Whitechapel, exactly as had been first suspected when Anderson returned from the continent. His identity was positively ascertained after he had been incarcerated. The only witness who had ever had a good sight of the murderer unhesitatingly identified him as soon as he saw him again, but refused to swear to his identification on learning that the suspect was a fellow Jew. Except that the recalcitrant witness could not possibly have been a city policeman, this identification sounded like the first of Major Griffith's three suspects. But Anderson's claim was instantly and resoundingly denied. Major Smith, the acting head of the city police in 1888, was writing his own memoirs, and he exploded. "I know more about these murders than any man living," he roared, going on to say that the Ripper completely beat him and every other policeman in London, and he could no more say 22 years later where he lived then than he could in 1888. As for Dr. Robert Anderson, he had misspent his time and was making recklessly uncharitable accusations against the law-abiding Jewish community. His suggestion that Polish Jews had shielded the murderer from justice was probably actionable. Anderson took the hint and recast the passage when his memoirs were republished in volume form. He carefully stated that Jewish referred only to the suspect's race and not his religion, and he dropped the references to the identification taking place after he had gone to an asylum, and the identifying witness being Jewish, either of which might have identified the witness and the occasion. In 1913, Sir Melville McNaughton, who had succeeded Anderson as head of the Metropolitan CID, retired and gave a farewell interview to the Daily Mail. He said that he greatly regretted having joined the police 6 months after Jack the Ripper committed suicide and never having had a go at him. He confirmed that he had a very good idea who he was and how he killed himself, but added that he had destroyed documentary evidence that had come into his possession and would never reveal the man's identity. The following year, he published his memoirs and asserted that the Ripper had killed himself on or about the 10th of November, 1888, though facts pointing to this conclusion only reached the police some years after McNaughton joined the force in July, 1889. Proof probably lay at the bottom of the Thames. It seemed as though McNaughton was referring to the third and likeliest of Major Griffith's suspects. When Detective Sergeant Stephen White died in 1919, an article in the People's Journal described him as the only policeman to have spoken to the Ripper, and quoted what purported to be, but transparently was not, an official report submitted by White about a night when he inspected the constables guarding a tiny cul-de-sac off Whitechapel Road. As he left, a well-dressed, cultivated young man came out of the alley and bade him good night in a musical voice. A few minutes later, one of the constables rushed out, having discovered a woman with her throat cut at the top of the alley. The writer suggested that this report had convinced Dr. Anderson that the murderer was a suspected Jewish medical student, something Anderson is not known to have believed. In 1923, William LeCue, a popular journalist, apparently pointed to Major Griffith's second suspect, the mad Russian doctor. In a book of sensational gossip, he claimed that a manuscript dictated by Rasputin revealed that the Ripper was the great Russian sex criminal Dr. Alexander Pedachenko, deliberately employed by the Tsarist secret police to discredit the Met, who tolerated Russian subversives and dissidents in East London, where they plotted from the safety of political asylum. LeCue had not mentioned this in two previous books on Rasputin because he had only just obtained independent evidence confirming Pedachenko's existence. Despite this suggestion of integrity, LeCue was known as an irresponsible, scaremongering sensationalist, and nobody paid much attention. Far more influential was a big feature in The People for Boxing Day 1926, written by the serious journalist, Member of Parliament, and Justice of the Peace, Leonard Matters. He had once read an article in Argentina reporting the death of an Englishman in Buenos Aires who had confessed to the Ripper murders. The man had been a brilliant surgeon whose only son was the apple of his eye. When the lad contracted syphilis after a drunken spree with Mary Jane Kelly, in consequence of which he lost his place at medical school, wasted his life, and died young, the father wanted revenge. He stalked the East End, killing the prostitutes he asked about his quarry, so that they should not give warning that he was on the trail. After inflicting condign punishment on Mary Jane, he emigrated and spent the rest of his life keeping a bar in Buenos Aires. A former pupil had recognized him during his terminal illness in hospital and received his deathbed confession. Matter's piece brought him a letter from a former demi-mondaine named Mrs. North, who believed his Dr. Stanley, an invented name shielding the identity of the real man, was a peculiar client she'd met in Shaftesbury Avenue in the autumn of 1888, who often made forays into the East End and vanished after the murders stopped. In 1929, Matters produced the first good book on the case. He gave a reasonable survey of the murders and recognised that the Scotland Yard rumours were the most important for him to counter. Anderson, he assumed, was referring to Pizer, not realising how completely his innocence had been established. Griffith's three suspects were all impossible, as their declared madness would have prevented them from foiling detection for 10 weeks. Dr. Stanley was, in Matters' view, the most likely suspect. In 1930, crime historian Hargrave Adam wrote that Sir Robert Anderson, Sir Melville McNaughton, and, astonishingly, Major Sir Henry Smith, had all individually told him that they knew who the Ripper was. He also said it was generally believed that he had syphilis, and this was probably the motive for the crimes. In 1931, Dr. Thomas Dutton died at an advanced age. He had lived in Aldgate from at least 1879 to 1891, and during the latter part of his life kept notebooks he called Chronicles of Crime. They were left to a Miss Hermione Dudley, who told the press that he believed the Ripper to be a middle-aged doctor avenging his son. That year, a former police constable named Robert Spicer told the Daily Express that he had nearly caught Jack the Ripper. On the night of the double murder, he had found a prostitute called Rosie sitting on a dustbin at the end of a court off Henage Street, Brick Lane, with a man who gave no good account of himself. Back at Commercial Street Police Station, Rosie refused to complain about the man who had given her a florin, 8 times the normal price of a knee trembler. And an array of inspectors in charge of the case had released the miscreant as soon as he proved himself to be a respectable Brixton doctor. Spicer was so disgusted, especially as he continued to see Jack lurking around Liverpool Street Station from time to time, that he ultimately resigned from the force. This last part of Spicer's story was not strictly true. He was dismissed for drunkenness in 1889. The persuasive tradition in his family runs that his suspect was actually a medical student from the London hospital and not a qualified doctor. But the Daily Express's great Ripper sensation of 1931 was the publication of what it described as a document left by the recently deceased spiritualist medium Robert James Lees. This described how Lees had psychically recognised the Ripper as a man on a London omnibus, had followed him to his home in Mayfair, and when he persuaded a policeman to accompany him, found that the man was a well-known doctor who suffered fits of amnesia and occasionally found inexplicable blood on his shirts. A committee of senior medics had sat in secret tribunal on the man and agreed that his death must be falsely announced while he was sent to an asylum in Islington under the name of Thomas Mason. Now, in fact, this was no document left by Lees. It was an almost verbatim transcription of an article from the Chicago Sunday Times Herald of 1895, alleging that a Dr. Howard had revealed the truth about the secret tribunal. Lees and his daughter had, however, made claims to clients and associates that he was involved in the Ripper investigation. Usually, he seems to have claimed that he identified a man whose wife held a high position in Victoria's court, and he had accepted a pension in return for keeping his mouth shut and moving quietly to St. Ives in Cornwall, where he could not be questioned. All his journal for 1888 reveals, however, is that he visited the police a couple of times, offering his mediumistic services, and they regarded him as a lunatic. In 1938, William Stewart published the last of the pre-war books on the Ripper. Taking up a suggestion of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's, he argued that only a midwife could have safely exhibited bloodstains in the East End at a time when everyone was looking for a sanguinary villain. He suggested that she might have been an illegal abortionist, but never claimed that his theory was more than speculation. The war put paid to Ripper research for some time. And then, in 1959, Donald McCormick published The Identity of Jack the Ripper. He took up Lecue's suggestion of Alexandra Pedachenko, adding information allegedly derived from Dr. Dutton's Chronicles of Crime, which he said he had discussed with the old man before he died 28 years previously. Coupled with a number of the Okhrana Gazette, the Tsarist Secret Police House Journal, this indicated that Pedachenko, alias Konovalov, alias Louis Corvo, had utilised the fact that he looked very like Abilene's suspect, Severin Klosowski, to cover his movements at night. Dutton, said by McCormick to have been a personal friend of Abilene's, supposedly believed that the inspector had changed his mind about Klosowski when he discovered this, and came to suspect Pedachenko. The identification was said to be supported by Sir Basil Thompson, a former CID chief, who certainly did write that the police of 1888 had believed the Ripper to be a mad Russian doctor who escaped arrest by committing suicide. According to Sir Charles Warren's grandson, this was Warren's belief too by the end of his life, though we know it had not been in 1888. McCormick claimed further that Thompson had written privately the Paris police had always suspected Pedachenko, whom they knew as Konovalov, but understood the London police to have known only by some other name. No one else has managed to trace the relevant number of the Okhrana Gazette. Dutton's Chronicles of Crime have not been seen since 1931, and no one but McCormick has ever reported seeing the letter in which Sir Basil Thompson allegedly recorded his discoveries in Paris around 1938. But that letter was about to go some strange transmogrifications, casting serious doubt on McCormick's very detailed work, as the real trail of Jack the Ripper suddenly opened up. Daniel Farson found it. One of Britain's first television stars, he met Melville McNaughton's younger daughter, Christabel, 2nd Baroness Aberconway, in 1959. And she showed him her copy of her father's notes on Jack the Ripper. 7 sheets typed by a secretary disposed of the case against Thomas Cutbush. 2 inserted sheets described 3 men against whom, in McNaughton's words, the police held a very reasonable suspicion. These crucial suspect descriptions were copied in Lady Aberconway's own hand for security reasons. For the next 5 years, she would not let anyone publish the names. Fascinated, Farson read that the three were 1. Mr. M.J. Druitt, a doctor of about 41 years of age and of fairly good family, who disappeared at the time of the Miller's Court murder and whose body was found floating in the Thames on 3rd December. McNaughton had been privately informed that Druitt's family thought he was the Ripper and he was sexually insane. 2. Kaminski, Kosminski or Kosmensky, a Polish Jew who lived in the very heart of the district where the murders were committed. He had become insane owing to many years' indulgence in solitary vices, i.e. masturbating. He was detained in a lunatic asylum about March 1889. This man, in appearance, strongly resembled the individual seen by the city PC near Mitre Square. 3. Michael Ostrog, a mad Russian doctor and a convict. This man was known to have carried about with him surgical knives and other instruments. His antecedents, i.e. criminal record, were of the very worst, and his whereabouts at the time of the Whitechapel murders could never be satisfactorily accounted for. It was apparent that names had at last been put to Major Griffith's three suspects. And McNaughton endorsed Griffith's preference for the drowned English doctor, saying that the most likely explanation of the Ripper's disappearance was that his brain gave way altogether after his awful glut in Miller's Court, and he then committed suicide. Though he also permitted the less likely alternative, that the Ripper's relatives found him to be so helplessly insane that they confined him to a lunatic asylum. An apparent reference to Kaminski-Kosminski, recalling Griffith's puzzling suggestion that his homicidal mania finally showed up after the commission of 5 atrocious murders. Farson was rightly satisfied that this was the best historical document ever produced on the Ripper, the closest to the source of serious investigation. 70 years on in time, he could not second-guess McNaughton. His research task was to find Dr. Druitt, whereupon snags showed up. No Dr. M.J. Druitt was on the medical registers, no M.J. Druitt had been born in 1847 or 48, and no Druitt appeared on the death registers for 1888. The mystery was solved when researchers ploughed on to 1889. Druitt's body had not been found on the 3rd, but the 31st of December. Lady Aberconway's tiny figure 1 in 31st had led to the misreading. Montague John Druitt's death was registered in January 1889. He was not a doctor. He was a barrister and schoolmaster. He was not 41 years old. He was 31. The errors of detail did not deter Farson. McNaughton, by his own admission, joined the force 6 months after Druitt's death ended the Ripper's activities. There was no need for him to have known precise details. Farson established that Druitt was educated at Winchester and Oxford, was born and buried at Wimborne, Dorset, had last been seen alive on or about December the 3rd, 1888. Farson went to press, with 2 television programmes describing him, but respecting Lady Aberconway's restriction and only naming him by the initials M.J.D. Farson went to press with 2 television programmes describing him, but respecting Lady Aberconway's restriction and only naming him by the initials M.J.D. Donald McCormick joined a panel discussion on the new discoveries and so saw the names on the McNaughton memorandum. The one that interested him was Ostrog. He'd already claimed that Pedachenko used the aliases Konovalov and Louis Kovo. Ostrog now unobtrusively joined the list. In the revised paperback edition of The Identity of Jack the Ripper, issued in 1962, the alleged letter written by Basil Thompson around 1938 was quoted differently, as saying that Konovalov used the alias Mikhail Ostrog, under which name Scotland Yard knew him. The 1970 revision of McCormick's book, however, recast many passages to include the McNaughton data with Lady Aberconway's permission. This time, McCormick quoted this letter with the name of Ostrog excised again. He apparently never anticipated that anyone would notice that the name had fleetingly appeared in his work after Farson showed it to him, with the claim that it was in the Thompson letter, which he had now twice quoted without it. This manifest tampering with quotation from a document casts very serious doubt on McCormick's scholarly integrity, and means that no document he cites can be trusted unless it's been seen by other researchers. In 1965, expatriate American journalist Tom Cullen published Autumn of Terror, detailing the McNaughton memorandum, names and all. Druitt was the ripper, said Cullen, suggesting that he might have intended to call attention to social conditions in the East End. Cullen drew uncritically on a huge range of newspaper sources. In a Reynolds News article of the 1950s, he found the claim that Scotland Yard's file was closed when the police concluded that a Polish sailor was the ripper. Cullen did not see the files himself. They were still closed to the public. Cullen's book was far and away the best that had ever appeared on the Ripper. Only Farson was displeased. He was working on his own book on the Ripper and working under the severe handicap that someone had cheekily come into Rediffusion Television's office and, claiming to be a researcher, asked to see Farson's Ripper file and made off with it. When he completed his own book, he remarked that he had been less than delighted to observe an untransmitted interview from his television programme preparations reported in someone else's work, indicating that the rival author had somehow gained access to the purloined file. Careful comparison of the books on the Ripper suggests that the reference must be to Autumn of Terror. Robin O'Dell wrote a responsible study of the case, offering the tentative theory that the Ripper might have been a shochet or Jewish ritual butcher, as such a man would have enjoyed the local respectability to reassure prostitutes and would have known techniques of throat-cutting which did not entail getting himself blood-stained. O'Dell was unaware that Major Smith had sent a set of shochet's knives to a pathologist who reported that they were curved and could not have been used for the Ripper murders. In 1970, an article in the obscure journal The Criminologist shifted the approach to the Ripper away from the sound historical lines pioneered by Farson. Dr. Thomas Stowell published a new theory, claiming that the Ripper was Queen Victoria's eldest grandson, Prince Albert Victor, Duke of Clarence. His mind had been deranged by syphilis contracted when he was 16. The royal family probably sent Queen Victoria's physician in ordinary, Sir William Gull, out to Whitechapel to trace him, since it was often rumoured that Gull had been seen there at the time of the murders. Incidentally, no such earlier rumours naming Gull in connection with the case had been traced. Clarence was probably caught and incarcerated after the double murders, escaping again to kill Mary Jane Kelly. Thereafter, when recaptured, he was given treatment that allowed him to make public appearances again, though his family was relieved when he died at the age of 29 in 1892. Now, there is not a word of truth in any of this. There is no evidence that the prince ever suffered from syphilis. Albert Victor was a serving soldier, as well as a member of the royal family, and his movements throughout the autumn of 1888 are thoroughly documented. Most of the time he was with his regiment in Yorkshire. On the day of one of the murders he lunched with the Queen, his grandmother, in Scotland. The nearest he ever came to Whitechapel at the time of a murder was Sandringham in Norfolk. No means of transport on earth at that time could have got him in and out of East London to commit the Ripper murders. But the damage was done. The sensational notion of a royal ripper sparked off the international obsession that now brings 250,000 tourists every year to the East End to visit the murder sites. And the field was open for cranks and charlatans and utterly naive theorists. Farson's publication of his own excellent Jack the Ripper did not curtail the nonsense. His book adduced interesting East End oral traditions and cautiously supported the McNaughton memorandum with a mysterious pamphlet called The East End Murderer, I Knew Him, which Druitt's cousin Lionel was supposed to have published in Australia. Farson's best efforts had failed to trace this, though there was no question that Lionel Druitt had emigrated to Australia before the murders. In the same year, Michael Harrison conclusively and finally refuted the claim that Clarence had been the Ripper. But for the frivolous reason that he felt it incumbent on him to find a replacement suspect, he came up with the lawyer-journalist Don J.K. Stephen, who had been Clarence's mentor and tutor in Cambridge. This man had suffered brain damage before his untimely death. Without any historical evidence whatsoever, Harrison speculated that he might have been homosexually involved with Clarence and committed the murders to signal his regret that his lover had broken the affair off. It is, of course, a completely absurd suggestion. Worse was to come. The BBC produced a television programme in which Inspector Barlow and John Watt of Zed Cars and Softly Softly fame investigated the mystery. Its real value lay in the excellent BBC research team's material produced for the scriptwriters. But they also threw their energies into two very unfortunate areas. First, they came across the suggestion that the word Jewes was a Masonic term and wondered whether Freemasons were involved. It is just possible that the term has been used in American Freemasonry, though the three mythical figures to which it refers are more normally called the Three Ruffians. In any case, they've not been a part of English Masonic ritual since 1814, and no Englishman would have heard of them in 1888. This was the first red herring. The second was worse. They researched the fantastic fairy tale told by a man who calls himself Joseph Sickert. He was born in 1925, third of the five children of William and Alice Margaret Gorman, née Crook. Living in Camden Town as an artist, picture restorer and dealer, he adopted the name of Camden's most famous artist and claimed to be the illegitimate son of Walter Sickert. By 1971, his fictional self-aggrandizement had grown. His mother was illegitimate and his grandfather's true identity is unknown. Joseph Sickert started claiming that his grandfather was the Duke of Clarence, and in fact his mother was legitimate, as there had been a secret Catholic marriage between Albert Victor and Annie Elizabeth Crook. He claimed that the Prime Minister, Lord Salisbury, had arranged for Annie to be kidnapped from their love nest in Cleveland Street, and had her falsely certified insane by Sir William Gull, so that she could be held in an asylum until her death in 1920. But an Irish Catholic nursemaid knew the secret. And when Mary Jane Kelly fell to East End prostitution, she and three cronies tried to blackmail the government. Salisbury again turned to his brother Freemason Sir William Gull, who took a closed carriage out to Whitechapel and searched for the blackmailing prostitutes. Whenever he found one, he lured her into the carriage, killed her, and mutilated the body after the manner of the injuries wished on himself by one of the three Jewes, or ruffians, as supposedly any Master Mason would recognise. The only one I've met who'd actually encountered this Masonic ritual didn't. This preposterous story was investigated by the young reporter Stephen Knight. He was, at least at first, completely taken in by Mr. Sickert, and his exciting book, Jack the Ripper, The Final Solution, contained fascinating additional details, both true and false. Among the latter, he said that Mr. William Gorman was impotent, for which reason Alice Margaret Crook left him and returned to Walter Sickert, who'd brought her up in Dieppe after her supposed parents' enforced separation. After Knight's sensational book appeared, Mr. Sickert recanted. He admitted the Ripper story was a whopping fib that he'd made up. He still, however, claimed to be the son of Walter Sickert and the grandson of the Duke of Clarence. Knight refused to withdraw, though research was steadily undermining his story, proving, for example, that Annie Elizabeth Crook had never been certified or held in an asylum, that William Gorman was far from impotent, and the birth registers recorded Joseph as his legitimate son. That Lord Salisbury was not a Freemason. Joseph Sickert went to ground for some years, until the arrest of Peter Sutcliffe, the Yorkshire Ripper. Then he went to a local paper with the story that Sutcliffe had varied his attacks on prostitutes by coming to London and trying to assassinate him, Joe Sickert, by running him down. Later, in the 1980s, after Knight's early death, he announced that he possessed two documents he'd forgotten about. One was an agreement entitling him to a share of the proceeds of Jack the Ripper, The Final Solution. The other was Abilene's Journal for 1896, which contained cryptic proof of the whole story. No serious Ripper expert paid any attention. Joseph Sickert was obviously a historical source with all the value of Baron Munchausen. But Joe Sickert's friend Melvin Fairclough listened sympathetically to the old man's revised stories and prepared them for publication late in 1991. Stephen Knight was now held mysteriously and personally responsible for the blown fiction that Billy Gorman was impotent. Joseph Sicker described his birth to a temporary liaison between the great painter and his obscure mother. He also got rid of the embarrassing non-Mason Salisbury as the organizer of the plot, replacing him with Lord Randolph Churchill. I must say one thing for Mr. Joseph Sickert. He knows the sensational names that will attract press attention. He has, however, contributed nothing but obfuscation and lies to the history of Jack the Ripper. It's a relief to return to reality. Shortly before Stephen Knight gave worldwide circulation to Joe Sickert's fantasies, Donald Rumbelow published The Complete Jack the Ripper. Concurrently with Knight's book, Richard Whittington Egan wrote A Casebook of Jack the Ripper, both authors eschewed trying to identify the murderer, contenting themselves with laying down facts as accurately as possible and critically examining some of the theories. Rumbelow, a serving city police officer, was already dedicated to rescuing valuable police archives from destruction. He had access to the Scotland Yard files, and before Stephen Knight had discovered that a copy of Melville McNaughton's memorandum in his own hand was deposited there. It was marginally shorter than the Aberconway version, though it added the details that there were many circumstances making Kosminski, the definite form of the name, a strong suspect, and that Ostrog subsequently went into a lunatic asylum as a homicidal maniac, again reminiscent of Griffiths's puzzling remark. McNaughton also introduced the suspects with the words, "I may here mention the cases of three men, any one of whom would have been more likely than Cutbush to have committed these murders." Rumbelow interpreted this to mean that the three were selected random from a larger list of unknown size. There was nothing, he argued, to prove that these were the most likely suspects, and there wasn't a shred of evidence to support McNaughton's conclusion that Druitt was the Ripper. The first point is not entirely true. Both Major Griffiths and G.R. Sims clearly understood that the final short list of three did represent the most likely suspects, and Griffiths' general descriptions showed that they must be Druitt, Kosminski and Ostrog. The second point is strictly true as it stands, but it cannot be extended, as some writers have done, to the claim that there isn't a shred of evidence against Druitt. We have no legal evidence against him, nothing we could take into court. Indeed, given that Druitt had recently been sacked from his school teaching for an unspecified serious offence, and that depressive madness and suicide ran in his family, we can see very strong reasons for supposing that he was not the Ripper. But McNaughton's suspicion is historical evidence. The final conclusion of a contemporary who knew the men on the case was closer to it than we are, and must have had reasons for believing what he did. Rumbelow strengthened Matter's case for rejecting Anderson's suspect. He not only believed Anderson meant Pizer, he traced reports of Violinia's abortive identification of him, and concluded this was the witness whom Anderson said had refused to swear to his identification. It was a persuasive argument, and only the subsequent demonstration that Anderson had said his suspect went into an asylum, which was not true of Pizer, completely undermined it. Rumbelow added a great deal of information to the genuine history of the Ripper. He was delighted by Major Smith's account of his investigation, and inclined to accept Smith's conclusion, running counter to Sedgwick Saunders' press conference, that the Lusk kidney really did come from Catherine Eddowes' body. The Lusk letter seemed to him the one that might just have truly come from the murderer. Rumbelow's very judicious refusal to commit himself to conclusions, coupled with the excellence of his original research, gave him his leading position among Ripper authorities. Richard Whittington Egan, doyen of British crime historians, declined to write yet another blow-by-blow account of the murders themselves. He confined himself to setting the record straight in important areas. He proved the non-existence of the pile of coins and rings at Annie Chapman's feet, which had been playing its part in the silly black magic and Freemasonry theories. He consulted renal specialists, and concluded that the Lusk kidney had certainly not come from Catherine Eddowes. He discovered a letter in which Dr. Benjamin Howard furiously disavowed the Chicago Sunday Times Herald story, ascribing to him the information about the secret tribunal on a mad doctor, now identified by Stephen Knight as Sir William Gull. Whittington Egan did not feel any case had yet been proven. And there the case stood for 10 years. Druitt looked the most likely candidate, yet there was terribly little to implicate him. Tom Cullen and Dan Farson still believed he was guilty. Everybody else confidently said, "Not a shred of evidence."